Nice to see you all. So let's open up with a word of prayer before we come to our first song. God, we thank you so much for this evening, and thank you for every chance we have to meet together, Lord. It's a blessing and it's a wonderful thing to come together to praise you, to leave behind any distractions and just to remember what really matters in life. And that's you. You are our all in all. You are our life. You are everything. And so we just pray that you'd help us to set our eyes on you this evening. Help us to worship you genuinely and to acknowledge why we worship you, Lord. That we're not worshiping you just because you made us or just because we're breathing, but also because of your Son and because we're saved because of your amazing grace. And we pray you bless this time, Lord. Bless our hearts as we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So our first song, I thought we could sing a few songs that we don't typically sing. And this one, My Jesus, My Savior, is one that I don't think we've sung in a while. And it's one of my favorites. I was looking at my favorite hymn list, and this was among them. So I thought, why not sing this one? So let's stand to sing. Song and praise God for that. And we're going to come to a time of prayer now. So there are a few things obviously we can be keeping in mind as we pray, firstly, we can be praying for the marathon on Sunday, God willing, for the gospel that's going to be shared there, and that goes well. We can pray for Chris, who tomorrow receives his MBE. So we look forward to that, and we just pray that God will. I'm not sure, but we want to pray that God will bless his speech. He's going to have about a minute, just over a minute, to speak, and he wants to share something that glorifies God and that points to him. So just pray that God will bless Chris. We can pray for a few people's health needs as well. So Nazia, who's had back pain, we can pray for her, for Daryl, for his heart and for his recovery. And also for my dad's cousin, Sarah, who will have a defibrillator on her heart on Saturday. And so just to pray that would go smoothly and she would be healed as a result. Maybe if a few of us could pray for the different health needs, but also for the gospel to be shared by the marathon and also through Chris as well, that God blesses him. So maybe a couple of us will pray and that would be great.
Thank you that we can sing your praises tonight. Thank you, Lord, as we sang. Nothing compares to what we have in you. There's so many things in the world that are temporary, that don't last, Lord, but in you we have eternal promises which never fail. So we thank you for salvation that we have through you, Lord. You are our Savior, you are our Lord. And we just come tonight to thank you. Lord, we pray for the outreach on Sunday at the marathon. Thank you for my friend Steve for organising that. And just pray for those of us who are taking part, Lord, that you give us the opportunity to share the gospel with people who are stood around with nothing to do and with whoever's around there, Lord. So we pray for that outreach. We pray also for Chris tomorrow as he goes to receive his award. We pray that you give him the words to say, that he will be able to share the gospel with people, to say that he's a Christian and he follows you, and you're the one who guides him in everything that he does. Perhaps, Lord, we don't know who he's going to speak with, whether it's the king or someone else, Lord. We just pray that you might give him an opportunity to share about you with that person. And tell them the gospel or something of what he believes, Lord. So we pray for boldness, pray for an open door for him, Lord, tomorrow. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Dear Father, I give thanks and praise for another opportunity to be here and to come and give you a praise. And thanksgiving, Father. I want to thank you for Gavin's cousin, Father, who has faithful heart problems, Father. You know all about her, dear Father. Please, Lord, it is your will, dear Father, please, in her heart condition to be 100% healed, Father. And most of all, dear Father, say, Lord, she is not safe, dear Father. You can do anything. You are the only one who can do anything, dear Father. Say prayers for whoever not well, dear Father. I didn't hear when I came. You know all about me, dear Father. Please, Lord, meet them and give them peace and heal them, please, Lord, dear Father. We want to pray for this troubled world. At the moment, dear Father, so many things are happening. People are so frightened because most of them, they don't know you, dear Father. People who know you, who are saved, they are praying, dear Father, to you, asking for help, dear Father. Please be with the people who don't know you and save themselves, and let them think about what they need most of all, dear Father. And they all need you, dear Father, more than anything else. to give to this church day by day, and giving the people who come here. Please, Lord, let them understand when they come on Sundays, and if they are not saved, dear Father, please speak to their hearts, dear Father. And thank you, Lord, for this time. Be with our pastor, who's going to bring the word. Cover him with your precious blood. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. We're going to sing our next hymn now, which is "He is Exalted." And it's a wonderful hymn. Again, is one I chose because we haven't sung it in a while. So let's stand to sing this a couple of times through. I'm going to hand over now to our brother Josiah to bring the notices for the coming week. Thanks, Joe.
Good evening.
Good evening. So yeah, the notices are as follows. Tomorrow we have 12 noon coffee morning as always. Thursday we have from 11:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Stamford Hill outreach to the Jewish community. At 7 p.m. we have a members meeting at the church, meeting here. So 7 p.m. till whatever time we finish, I guess 9 or whenever we usually finish. If possible earlier, yeah. You should have had email of minutes if you remember. If you haven't, and or you want the paper copy, there's a paper copy available here if you want to collect one. Friday, 9:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. normal Grace Talks, and 6 to 7 p.m. regular Friday club. Saturday we have our first aid course, so still there's time to sign up.
Please,
and if you want to, or interests you, or you're involved in the children's outreach, or in any way you want to get involved, it's £12. It's half price, offered to us at a discount. And if money's an issue and you are involved with the kids, then obviously speak to Asa or Sean, and they'll sort that out, and the church will cover the cost. Not a problem.
I should be there just before 10. It'll be like a quarter to 10.
So 9:45 to be there, starting at 10. And should be around 2 hours or so long. Next Sunday, we have our regular morning service at 10:45, led by our brother Chris Simons, MBE, which will be true at that point, I think. Leading and speaking, and then our pastor's at Tollington Park in the morning. And then 4 p.m. Prothero House, if you're interested, speak to the pastor if you're interested in going to that. It's Old Folks Home. 4:30 p.m. we have a holiday Bible club prayer and planning meeting, which is our first meeting for this upcoming holiday Bible club. So if you plan to be involved in that, or you want to be involved in the planning of that, then it's at 4:30 p.m. on Sunday afternoon. So we're going to start discussing the theme and all the practicalities of that. 6 p.m. evening communion service, again looking at the church, the theme of the church, and it's the C team for cleaning and serving. And just one last thing, a thank you for those who gave to the charity. It was a total of £326.54 raised from our black box, which is above our normal box. And all these are subject to God's will. Thank you.
Thanks, Josiah.
Okay, so we're going to have our reading now. So if you have a Bible, feel free to turn there. Otherwise, you can listen along. It's 1 John chapter 1. And because it's not a very long chapter, we're going to read the whole of it. So 1 John chapter 1. And it says this. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness, and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be full. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Amen. And we're going to be coming back to that in just a moment after we sing our final song for this evening, which is Jesus Christ, I Think Upon Your Sacrifice. And the chorus, once again, I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. And I love those words there. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. It's as we realize our own sin and his mercy, as we look at the cross, and the more we see his mercy, the more we realize how sinful we are. And I think that's a powerful thought. So let's stand to sing our final song together.
Yeah.
Praise God. So if you have a Bible, just you can turn back to 1 John chapter 1, which is where we'll be focusing this evening. And my hope is that we will have more of an understanding of what it's saying by the end. So we will be exploring the wording a bit, exploring other passages, and taking a look at hopefully what it means. And then later there'll be a time for discussion. So if you disagree with anything, feel free to hold your thoughts and you can share them then. And you know, it's always good to be critical as well. But we are going to jump straight in to looking at 1 John chapter 1. And we're focusing on verses 5 through to 10, the second half of the passage. And so why don't we pray just before we jump in and begin exploring that. Father, we thank you for this opportunity again. Thank you for your word, and we thank you for how precious it is to us, Lord. We love your word, we delight in it, and we just pray that your word would be clear to us, that we would understand, but also we'd be more and more like you as a result of what we hear this evening. So Lord, bless us, bless each one of us, and give us the grace to glorify you in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, firstly, when we look at this passage, there's a few things that stand out, and there's a few things I thought it was saying originally, and I don't believe it's saying that necessarily, to the same way that I did think it was before. So, firstly, what I thought it said, okay, so we're going to just take a quick look at what I thought it said. We're going to then move into a few other scriptures, some surrounding verses and things like that. But for now, what I thought it said. Firstly, in verse 6, which is the first one that I believe I had a misunderstanding of, it says, "If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth." Originally, I thought that said, Christians in fellowship with God cannot sin. Christians in fellowship with God cannot sin. Okay? And if they do, they are kind of cut off from God simply by their sin. Verse 7, the next one, I'm just going to read it and then you'll see what I thought it said. "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin." So if we walk in the light, and how I understood that is by being good, we maintain that forgiveness of God. And we don't have necessarily that forgiveness if we sin, if we mess up. The next one is verse 9, and there's three things here that I'm pointing out. So verse 9 says this: "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." And I thought that said, each sin that we commit causes us to lose forgiveness, to lose the fellowship we have with God. We must confess each sin to regain our forgiveness and our fellowship. In other words, we're not necessarily children of God anymore, or we lose that closeness, we lose that fellowship, we lose even the forgiveness of sin by our sin. Which we already know, there should be alarm bells going off, that we do believe in forgiveness of sins, not just that we have committed pre-salvation, but we do believe in forgiveness of sins that even we commit as Christians. Really, the worst sins are the ones we commit as Christians. They're the most serious. God takes them the most seriously. But we do believe that there is forgiveness. And my view that I had previously, I think, is similar to the old covenant, but without the sacrifice. The old covenant was, you sin, you mess up, you go to God, you confess, and you sacrifice your animal, and then you regain that forgiveness. But once you sinned in the old covenant, you know, your sins separated you. Your sins came between you, and God couldn't look on you with grace. Whereas we believe in justification, and the justification doesn't just cover us until we sin. It covers us even though we sin as Christians. And we're going to get later on to what that means for us. Does that mean we continue in sin, that grace may abound? Can we use that covering as a means to just sin? And we're going to look into those questions, hopefully, later on. But for now, this is what I thought. And I think this was closer to the Roman Catholic plan of salvation, or their understanding, which is visualized by this diagram, where, okay, we're made righteous by our first confession of faith, but then we can sin, and we can come crashing down by our sins. And unless we pick ourselves back up again in terms of forgiveness, we have lost it. Whereas we believe the biblical plan of salvation, as this shown in this diagram, is that we're made righteous and there's no condemnation on the basis of what Christ has done for us. And that though we fall at times, as long as we are walking in the light, as long as our eyes remain on Jesus, as long as we believe and trust in him and seek first the kingdom, we are children of God, there is a covering for our sin. There is forgiveness. As long as we don't fully turn our backs on God, no believer can do that, we remain covered and we remain forgiven. And we're going to see later on what that means for us. So if you see something that doesn't look right, you've probably seen something similar to this in the tube. If you see something that doesn't look right, speak to British Transport Police on 61016. I think that's what they say. But no, if you see something that doesn't look right in the scriptures, there's a few things you can do. Firstly, you check the surrounding verses. Secondly, you can check other scriptures and you can see if it lines up with the rest of scripture. And thirdly, you can take a closer look at the passage and the wording of the passage to hopefully understand it a little bit better. So the first thing we're going to do this evening is to take a look at the surrounding verses. Then we're going to look at some other scriptures briefly. Then we're going to take a closer look at the passage and hopefully we'll see that that's not necessarily what it's saying, and dive into it a bit deeper. So surrounding verses, if you look at 1 John chapter 2, the first two verses, we see that Christians do sin. It's a sad thing. It grieves the Holy Spirit, but it is something that we need to admit and be humble and honest about. We do sin. So it says here, my little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. And so believers sin. I once asked someone, is there any Bible verse that tells us that believers sin? And I was pointed to this verse that clearly says, if anyone sins, speaking of believers, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. So there is that security that though we fail, though like that diagram I showed you earlier, we're saved but we trip up, we fall from time to time, probably more often than we are willing to admit, God upholds us ultimately in the faith and covers those sins. The cross is sufficient and the blood of Jesus is sufficient. So there are the surrounding verses. We see that Jesus isn't necessarily waiting for our confession in order to forgive us. Jesus is our advocate. Even for those sins that we don't recognize, even those sins that go unnoticed. Today, I'm sure many of us, I'm probably sure that all of us have committed sins, whether that's pride or irritability or some kind of sin, and we don't even know we committed it. But God sees it, and we didn't confess it, but praise God we have an advocate. That despite our failure to confess, he will cover those sins as long as we remain in Christ, as long as we hold on to him, and as long as we are born again and have the Holy Spirit. So there's the surrounding verses. Next, other scriptures. If you look at the new covenant that we are under compared to the old covenant, the new covenant tells us that we're forgiven, and that's why we know God. Our relationship with God is based on our forgiveness. So it says in Jeremiah, prophesying the new covenant, it says, they shall all know me, and notice the reason, they all shall know me later, for I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. So why do we know God? Why has he welcomed us into his family. Why are we children of God? Is it because we're good people? No, not necessarily. He didn't choose the cream of the crop. But the reason is because he will forgive their iniquity and their sin he will remember no more. There is that past, present, and future forgiveness. Hopefully you'll hear me over the sound of this dripping rain. So, other scriptures, again, other verses in the Bible, we would actually have to twist to fit this understanding of scripture into the Bible. So for example, this is a well-known Bible verse. I think we'd have to twist this scripture to make it say what I thought this verse was saying. So we know the scripture very well. I think we'd have to add in a few words here. He was wounded for our confessed transgressions. He was bruised for our confessed iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed, until we trip up and wound ourselves again. We are healed, and that healing is despite our sin as believers. And we're going to get to later on, again, the big pressing question of what does that mean for us in terms of righteousness? But for now, we do sin, and I think that's something we have to admit. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin, as long as you confess it. Another one, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him, until we sin again. We're made righteous, we're justified. Is it only until we sin? Or does his justification cover us, even despite our failure? I think those who would say his justification only is active until we sin, probably don't recognize the amount of sin that we commit as Christians, how sinful we are. I think we've been looking at Romans 7 recently and the battle we have as Christians and how we have to be honest, that we've got the flesh as well as the spirit. And if he only made us righteous until we sin, we would have close to no hope. I would say no hope. Praise God that he covers us in our sin as well. And again, this is something that's hard to understand. Past, present, and future sins covered, even though we are flawed people. What does this mean for us? And so we're going to get to that later on, as I keep saying. So now let's take a closer look at the passage. We've looked at the surrounding verses. We've looked at some other scriptures that seem to be pointing to the fact that we are forgiven, that forgiveness is a security in Christ, as long as we are born again in Christ, walking by the Spirit, not by the flesh. But now we're going to take a look at this passage a bit more closely. So if you look at verse 6 of 1 John chapter 1, it says, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. Walk in darkness is the key phrase. Walking in darkness literally means, in my understanding of it, to live in sin. If we as believers, well, at least if we claim to be believers, but we're living in sin, we're not believers. The Bible's clear about that. We cannot walk in darkness. And so that's maybe how I would rephrase it. I mean, that's how the Bible verse literally puts it. If we walk in darkness, claiming to have fellowship with him, we're lying. So one commentator, for example, put it this way. This does not speak of an occasional lapse, but of a lifestyle of darkness. So we as Christians, on the other hand, walk in the light. And that's verse 7. This is telling us that we walk in the light. And this is a lifestyle of walking in the light, of pleasing God, or at least seeking to please him with our lives. We have the Holy Spirit. We're born again. We're made righteous in him. He's given us the power to walk a righteous life. And every believer bears fruit. There is no believer who's ever made it to the kingdom who didn't bear fruit. Even the thief on the cross had some fruit, even in his words, even in his heart on the cross. So we will bear fruit, and he will cause us to bear more fruit by the power of his Holy Spirit if we are true believers. So we will walk in the light. This isn't a tightrope that we're walking as Christians, where if we slip up, it's game over. This isn't just a second chance but this is a covering by his grace for those who walk by the Spirit. Verse 9, the final one, we are forgiven and cleansed if we confess our sins. Now, John here is attacking two extremes, okay? So the first extreme that he's attacking in this passage is the extreme that we're sinless, thinking that we're sinless as Christians. And I believe he was attacking that. I heard today that he was writing to the Gnostics, and the Gnostics believe that we don't sin. They don't believe in sin. And so because of this, they were thinking they were sinless. And so John had to attack that idea that we're sinless. And he had to point out again and again, if we say we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. And so this passage in verse 9, for example, is sandwiched between verses 8 and verse 10, which both say that we have sinned and prove that we have sinned. It says in verse 8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And then it says in verse 10, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. So between these two verses saying we can never say we're sinless as Christians, we have sinned, is a verse that says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. What's his point? I believe his point is, therefore, that we have to acknowledge that we are sinners if we want to be saved. There's no one who ever will be saved who doesn't believe that they are sinners, who doesn't confess their sin. That doesn't necessarily mean confess every single individual sin, because I don't believe any Christian has ever done that. But it does mean that we have to walk in a continual confession that we are sinners and that we depend on the continual cleansing and the continual forgiveness of our Savior. And this is even proved by the way we came to salvation. When Rob, for example, as a full-time evangelist, shares the gospel, he doesn't expect the person he's sharing the gospel with to confess every individual sin that they ever have committed. What do they have to confess? They don't confess every individual sin. What they confess is that they are sinners. They say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And same with Christians. We don't necessarily confess each and every sin. We should. Don't get me wrong. Please don't get me wrong. Confession for sin is great. If you ever do sin, I would recommend bringing that to God, being honest and saying, Lord, I've failed in this way. Please cleanse me. Please make it so that I never commit this sin again. But ultimately, confession of sin isn't a condition of forgiveness. Individually confessing each and every sin, forgiveness precedes our sin as well. And this is a wonderful, wonderful, mind-blowing truth that I can't understand, and I don't know if you can, but praise God for his amazing grace. And I believe even if you've been a Christian for many, many years, which many of us in this room, many of you in this room have probably been a Christian for much longer than I have. I've been a believer for 10 years or so, but I'm sure if we went around the room, we'd see that many have been a believer for longer than that. As you grow in your faith, you should be acknowledging sin even more. Now, I know that's quite odd, because as you grow, you should be increasing in righteousness. But actually, I believe you should also be growing in an awareness of your sin as you grow in faith. The more close you get to the Lord, the more brightly he exposes those sins in your life. And so I want to read just briefly a short section of this book I've been reading called The Discipline of Grace, which I recommend very highly. But I just want to read a short passage from this book that explains that as we grow in righteousness, we should be seeing our sin even more. Think of yourself walking into a room where the lighting is controlled by a dimmer switch. As you walk in, the lighting is dim, and you see the furniture all in place, no newspapers lying around, and no dirty cups on the coffee table. The room looks neat and clean. But as you turn up the wattage in the lights, you begin to see dust on the furniture, smudges on the walls, chips in the paint, and threadbare spots in the carpet. The room that looked all right in the dim light suddenly appears dirty and unattractive under the full glare of the brighter light. That is what happens in the life of a person who is pursuing holiness. At first, your life may appear fairly good because you've been a decent sort of person and no gross sins are visible. Then the Holy Spirit begins to turn up the wattage of His Word and reveal the more subtle, refined sins of which you were not even aware. Or perhaps you were aware of certain thoughts or actions but have not realized they were sinful. So as you grow in your spiritual life, you should even be more aware of your sin as you walk in that continual confession. So what's John's point in 1 John? I believe it's this, that Christians need to walk in the whole truth of God's word. The truth that we're sinners, the truth that God is just, faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us. He's merciful, He's gracious. We're sinners, God is gracious, but also the truth that we're born again and that we're walking in the light as Christians. There is no Christian who can claim to have fellowship with God while walking in the darkness. We're walking in the light. We will fall while we walk in the light, but when we sin, we're not turning our backs on God. We're not starting to walk in darkness. We're falling, but with a heart of repentance. We're sorry for our sin. We regret our sin. We love God. And that's evidence, really, that we're saved. Guilt, even, is an evidence of salvation. When you sin and you feel guilty, let that point you even to Christ as well. So he's saying we're not pick and mix. We don't pick and mix. We're not saying, I'm going to take this truth that we're saved by grace, but forget the truth that I'm walking in the light. Or I'm going to walk in the light, but forget the truth that I'm forgiven. We take the whole of God's word, the whole truth that he reveals to us. So for example, the Bible warns against using our freedom in 1 Peter 2:16 as a cover-up for evil. So we have the robe of righteousness that covers us, and he warns against taking that robe of righteousness and saying, well, then I can do what I want. I'm forgiven, so who cares? Using God's grace as an excuse for sin. And I would argue that this is the height of evil. Taking God's grace and saying, therefore, I'm going to do what I want. I think that is the height of evil. I've come across some Christians who believe in God's grace, and they would even laugh at sin in a way. It's kind of like, isn't it funny that we sin? And, you know, we have to remember the seriousness of sin. Sin took our Savior to the cross, and feel the weight of it. It grieves the Holy Spirit to this day. Even though we're covered and he does see us as righteous, still when we sin, it grieves him. And so it's the height of evil, in my opinion. If, for example, if one of you came into my home and let's say you splashed your coffee on the ground, a little bit of coffee, you said, oh, I'm sorry about that. And I said, don't worry about it. Let me just mop that up. And then you said, oh, great. And you tipped your whole mug of coffee all over the floor. And maybe you smashed the glass, the mug on the floor. You know, that is pure evil. You know, and when God is gracious and when God forgives us of our sin and we say, therefore, I'm going to just take advantage. In my opinion, that is the height of evil. And this is where we're coming to the end now as we really zoom in on grace and how God avoids this problem of grace. Grace can be misused. People can take grace, and the Bible says again and again, they say, oh, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? And there are people who do that, who think they're covered, and so they live however they want. I've come across Muslims, when you share with a Muslim that you're saved by God's grace, they say, oh, that must mean that you don't care about righteousness then. You don't care about living a good life, because obviously, if God just forgives it, then what's the point? And we have to point out, no, that when you're grateful, you're so grateful for what God has done, and he transforms you from the inside, then you long to please God. You long to live a life of righteousness. And you hate and despise sin. So there are two main reasons that I want to share with you how God avoids this problem of people misusing his grace. Two main problems, two main ways that he avoids it. Firstly, God won't be mocked. God won't be mocked. The Bible says it, God will not be mocked. I believe, and I think it's true from Scripture, that no person will ever be able to successfully take advantage of God's grace. There will be no person ever who will be able to say, well, that's great, I've got God's grace, the blessing of walking in this direction, and I'm going to take that blessing and I'm going to walk in darkness. And I'm going to keep that blessing of grace while I'm walking in the complete opposite direction. There's no person who can do that, because the blessing of God's grace comes with walking in the light. It's part of the light. It's part of the blessing of walking in righteousness and by the Spirit. So we cannot have God's grace while we walk in by the flesh. The Bible makes that clear, that those who are born again, those who are children of God, are those who walk in the light. We're children of the light. We're those who seek to please Him. So no one will ever be able to do that. Every true believer is born again, and that means they're given the power of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is sufficient to transform them. We have all that we need to be made righteous, more and more in our daily lives. Not free from sin, never, until we die, until we meet the Lord, but more and more like our Savior. And so there's no grace for anyone who walks in darkness, who walks away from God's way. And I want to share another short passage from this book, just the last one that is along these lines, and I think it's quite helpful. So it says this: when our sense of guilt is taken away because our consciences are cleansed by the blood of Christ, we are freed up to love Him with all our hearts and souls and minds. In fact, not only are we freed up, we are motivated in a positive sense to love Him in this wholehearted way. Our love will be spontaneous in an outpouring of gratitude to Him and fervent desire to obey Him. Jesus said, "He who has been forgiven little loves little." In the context of that statement, He essentially said the converse is also true. Those who have been forgiven much, love much. Therefore, we can say that the extent to which we realize and acknowledge our own sinfulness, and the extent to which we realize the total forgiveness and cleansing from those sins, will determine the measure of our love for God. So if we want to grow in our love for God, and in the acceptable obedience that flows out of that love, we must keep coming back to the cross and the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ. That is why it's so important that we keep the gospel before us every day, because we sin every day and our consciences condemn us every day. We need the gospel every day. So the second point is that God's grace motivates righteousness. And we're going to discuss this in a moment, God willing, in one of the questions. God's grace motivates righteousness. The first one, God will not be mocked. But the second one, God's grace motivates righteousness. Righteousness. It says here, those who have been forgiven much, love much. So as you see the wonder of God's grace, you know, you want to honor Him more and more. You want to live a life that pleases Him. I think that's just how it works. You want to be kind to someone who's kind to you. It's typically how it works. And the people who are most kind to you, it would be the most evil of you to be unkind to them. And Jesus has done so much for us. He's laid down His life for us. The last thing we want to do is displease Him and sin against Him. So God's grace also motivates that righteousness in us. In Monopoly, there's the get out of jail free card. And when you get that card, it doesn't mean that you want to get into jail. It doesn't make you want to get into jail. But it does mean that when you are in jail, that you have that get out of jail free card. And it's similar to the grace that rescues us from sin. The grace that rescues us from sin doesn't encourage us to sin. The grace tells us that the sin was evil, and therefore I've rescued you from it. And so the grace encourages us to live more righteously. And so that's why, come to the end now, in chapter 2 and verse 1, it says, "I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin." I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. These things that he's writing to us include God's grace, God's call to righteousness, and the fact that we are sinners. As we're aware of our sinfulness, as we're aware of God's grace, and as we're aware that we are born again and that we walk in the light, and not in the darkness. We will be encouraged not to sin. These are things that encourage us. And there will be an opportunity to share your opinion on that in just a moment. Does grace motivate righteousness? The more you hear about God's mercy, does that make you want to please him more? Does that make you want to live for him? And it'll be interesting to hear what you have to say. But for now, let's come to a time of prayer. And let's just pray that God will help us. We'll take away our sin. We'll remind us that we're sinners. Help us to keep that mentality. But also help us to walk more and more in the light. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you that you've shown us, Lord, through your word, that we are sinners. Lord, we fail you, and Lord, it grieves us when we sin, as it grieves you. Lord, we know that we sin more than we are willing to share, and we sin more than we even acknowledge. Lord, we fail you. Sin means missing the mark, and Lord, we know we miss the mark every day. We miss the mark. We don't love as we should. We don't treat others as we should. We don't love you as we should, Lord. And we do see our own sin as we behold how righteous and how good you are. But Lord, we thank you that your good news shows us that we are forgiven through Christ. It says here, cleanse from all unrighteousness. And we just thank you for that cleansing. We thank you for the blood of Jesus that provides us with that cleansing. We thank you for the Holy Spirit who provides us with the power to live lives that honor you, who transforms us and cleans our hearts more and more. So Lord, help us to walk in a way that honors you. Help us to love you more and more, and help us to acknowledge your grace as we run this race, Lord. So Lord, be glorified in us as we discuss your word now. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we're going to come to a time of discussion. I'm just thinking.